Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you brought us here together before you and your word. We ask you, Lord, that you help us give you our undivided attention, Lord. Lord, as we go through the study on the book of Joel, we ask you, Lord, that you help us take seriously all the warnings that you gave your people in this early recorded prophecy. Lord, help us also respond and completely repent and surrender ourselves to you as our only Lord, as our only source, as our only Redeemer, our only Savior, our only Provider, our only Protector. We ask you, Lord, that you help us see you as you really are, dear God, so that we will give you what is due you for being our Creator and the love that is due you from us for being our Redeemer. Amen. We thank you, Lord, for living the perfect life in our place and then dying the death that we deserved, being tortured not just for our sins, the propitiation for our sins, but also the sins of the world. Thank you, Lord, that you made it available to anyone who would call to you in faith, and you would forgive their sins and cleanse them with your holy, precious blood. They could be restored in relationship with you and call God Daddy, our Father. Thank you, Lord, for that kind of reconciliation. Lord, help us do our job before you in the world in this ministry of reconciliation so that others can be restored in relationship to you. Lord, help us take seriously this message that we are in good standing and right relationship with you with nothing getting in the way, Lord. Nothing of the world. Nothing of the things that distract us, to keep us from what you're calling us to do, to keep us on a path in rebelling against you. We ask you, help us, Lord. Help us take seriously all these things. Thank you, Lord, for the power of your Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for opening up the truth of the inside of our heart to us so that we can repent. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for opening up our eyes to see our need for a Savior. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for showing us our Savior, Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for the power that you offer us and the power that you give us. Power to be led by you. Power to understand your word. Power to have our hearts transformed. And power to obey. We thank you for all these things, Lord. We ask that you help us understand all the things that are in your word, especially this prophecy of Joel, dear God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Ruler of all nature, O thou of God and man the Son. Thee will I cherish, thee will I honor, thou my soul's glory, joy, and there are the meadows, there is still the woodlands, robed in the blooming garb of spring. She Jesus is fairer, Jesus is purer, who makes the woeful heart to sing. Fair is the sunshine, fair is still the moonlight, and all the twinkling starry hosts. Jesus shines brighter, Jesus shines purer than all the angels have and hold. All fair is beauty, heavenly and earthly, wondrously Jesus is found in thee. None can be nearer, fairer or dearer than thou, my Savior, art to me. Beautiful Savior, Lord of the nations, Son of God and Son of Man, glory and honor, praise, adoration, now and forevermore be thine. Maranatha, Lord, we seek you. Every heart here waits as one. Lord, draw near us, for we need you. Maranatha, O Lord Jesus, come. O Lord, come. Oh, Lord, come. We await your presence. Oh, Lord, come. Come and feed us. We long to see you. Maranatha, oh, Lord Jesus, come. Where your people join together, Lord, your Spirit fills that place. You are here now, Lord, forever, now in spirit, but one day face to face. O Lord, come, O Lord, come. We await your presence, O Lord, come. Come and meet us, we long to see you. Maranatha, O Lord Jesus, come. Now we watch, Lord, for your appearing. When the veil is torn away, as we see our freedom clearing, may this prayer grow stronger every day. O Lord, come, O Lord, come. We await your presence, O Lord, come. Come and meet us. We long to see you. Maranatha, O Lord Jesus, come. O Lord, come. O Lord, come. We await your presence, O Lord, come. Come and meet us. We long to see you. Maranatha, O Lord Jesus, come. Maranatha, O Lord Jesus, come. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Break me, melt me, mold me, and use me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Break me, melt me, mold me, and use me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Living water, fill my thirsty soul. Holy Spirit, come. Bread of life, fill my aching need. Holy Spirit, come. For I am nothing without your love. Breathe new life in me. Then will my life bring glory unto you. Holy Spirit, come. Living water, fill my thirsty soul. Holy Spirit, come. Bread of life, fill my aching need. Holy Spirit, come. For I am nothing without your love. Breathe new life in me. Then will my life bring glory unto you. Holy Spirit, come, for I am nothing without your love. Breathe new life in me, then will my life bring glory unto you. Holy Spirit, come. Then will my life bring glory unto you. Holy Spirit, sweet Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit. Oh. Again. We praise thee, O God, for thy Spirit of light, who hath shown us our Savior and scattered our night. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory, revive us again. All glory and praise to the Lamb that was slain, who hath borne all our sins and hath cleansed every stain. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again. All glory and praise to the God of all grace, who hath bought us and sought us and guided our ways. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again. Revive us again, fill each heart with thy love. May each soul be rekindled with fire from above. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again. The Lord is my strength and my song, and he is become my salvation. He is my God, and I shall prepare him my heart. And I shall prepare him my heart. And I shall prepare him my heart. The Lord, he shall reign forever and ever. Amen. The Lord. And I shall prepare you my heart. And I shall prepare you my heart. And I shall prepare you my heart. Oh, Lord, you shall reign forever and ever. Amen. Oh, Lord, you shall reign forever and ever. And I shall prepare you my heart. And I shall prepare you my heart. Yes, I shall prepare you my heart.
Lord Jesus, we thank you for coming, for taking our place, for doing everything that was necessary so that we could be saved. Thank you, Lord, for the Holy Spirit that you promised. Thank you, Lord, that your Holy Spirit works alongside of us. And once we've placed our faith in you and have believed that what you did on the cross, you did for us, your Holy Spirit indwells us. Thank you, Jesus. By your blood, you purchased us. You bought our bodies so that our bodies would become the temple of your Holy Spirit right now. Lord, manifest your presence through our bodies, Lord, so that people will be drawn to you as they seek the Lord, as they seek truth. And your Holy Spirit will then, in that hour, give us the words that they need to hear, the words that are going to come directly from you. Lord, help us live our lives to display you among this world so that people are going to know that you're real, the way we respond and the way we react, the way we trust, the way we have peace, and the way we have joy, regardless of the circumstances or the things surrounding us or the people in our lives, regardless of any of these things, Lord, we ask you help us. Thank you, Lord, for your Holy Spirit in our lives, for the power of your Holy Spirit that allows us to proclaim who you are and display to the world who you are. We ask you help us, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Open up your Bibles to the book of Joel. I'm going to start reading from Joel chapter 1, verse 1, go through it so we have a full context of the book again. And then we'll pick up from where we left off. The word of the Lord that came to Joel, the son of Pethuel: hear this, ye old men, and give ear, all ye inhabitants of the land. Hath this been in your days, or even in the days of your fathers? Tell ye your children of it, and let your children tell their children, and their children another generation. That which the palmerworm hath left, hath the locust eaten. That which the locust hath left, hath the cankerworm eaten. That which the cankerworm hath left, hath the caterpillar eaten. Awake, ye drunkards, and weep and howl, ye drinkers of wine, because of the new wine, for it is cut off from your mouth. For a nation has come up upon my land, strong and without number, whose teeth are the teeth of a lion. He hath the cheek teeth of a great lion. He hath laid my vine waste and barked at my fig tree. He hath made it clean bare and cast it away. The branches thereof are made white. Lament like a virgin girded with sackcloth for the husband of her youth. The meat offering and the drink offering is cut off from the house of the Lord. The priests and the Lord's ministers mourn. The field is wasted, the land mourneth, for the corn is wasted. The new wine is dried up, the oil languisheth. Be ye ashamed, O ye husbandmen. Howl, O ye vine dressers, for the wheat and for the barley, for the harvest of the field is perished. The vine is dried up, and the fig tree languisheth. The pomegranate tree, the palm tree also, and the apple tree, even with all the trees of the field, are withered, because joy is withered away from the sons of men. Gird yourselves and lament, ye priests. Howl, ye ministers of the altar. Come lie all night in sackcloth, ye ministers of my God. For the meat offering and the drink offering is withholden from the house of your God. Sanctify ye a fast, call a solemn assembly, gather the elders and all the inhabitants of the land into the house of the Lord your God, and cry unto the Lord. Alas for the day of the Lord is at hand, as a destruction from Almighty shall it come. Is not the meat cut off before our eyes? Yea, joy and gladness from the house of our God. The seed is rotted under their clouds, the gardeners are laid desolate, the barns are broken down, the corn is withered. How do the beasts groan, and the herds of the cattle are perplexed, because they have no pasture? Yea, the flocks of sheep are made desolate. O Lord, to thee will I cry, for the fire hath devoured the pastures of the wilderness, and the flame hath burned all the trees of the field. The beasts of the field cry also unto thee, for the rivers of waters are dried up, and the fire hath devoured the pastures of the wilderness. Blow ye the trumpet in Zion, and sound an alarm in my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord cometh, for it is nigh at hand, a day of darkness, of gloominess, a day of clouds and of thick darkness. As the morning spread upon the mountains, a great people and a strong, there hath not been ever the like, neither shall be any more after it, even to the years of many generations. A fire devoureth before them, and behind them a flame burneth. And the land is as the Garden of Eden before them, and behind them a desolate wilderness. Yea, and nothing shall escape them. The appearance of them is as the appearance of horses, and as horsemen, so shall they run. Like the noise of chariots on the tops of the mountains, they shall leap. Like the noise of a flame of fire that devoureth the stubble, as a strong people set in battle array. Before their face the people shall be much pained. All faces shall gather blackness. They shall run like mighty men. They shall climb the walls like men of war. They shall march every one on his ways, and they shall not break their ranks. Neither shall one thrust any other. They shall walk every one in his path, and when they fall upon the sword, they shall not be wounded. They shall run to and fro in the city. They shall run upon the wall. They shall climb upon the houses. They shall enter in at the windows like a thief. The earth shall quake before them. The heavens shall tremble. The sun and the moon shall be dark. The stars shall withdraw their shining. And the Lord shall utter his voice before his army, for his camp is very great. For he is strong that executeth his word. For the day of the Lord is great and very terrible, and who can abide it? Therefore also now, saith the Lord, turn ye even to me with all your heart, and with fasting, and with weeping, and with mourning, and rend your hearts, not your garments. Turn unto the Lord your God, For he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and of great kindness, and repenteth him of the evil. Who knoweth if he will return and repent and leave a blessing behind him, even a meat offering and a drink offering unto the Lord your God. Blow the trumpet in Zion, sanctify a fast, call a solemn assembly, gather the people, sanctify the congregation, assemble the elders, gather the children and those that suck the breasts. Let the bridegroom go forth of his chamber and the bride out of her closet. Let the priests and the ministers of the Lord weep between the porch and the altar. Let them say, spare thy people, O Lord, and give not thine heritage to reproach, that the heathen should rule over them. Wherefore should they say unto the people, where is their God? Then the Lord will be jealous for his land and pity his people. Yea, the Lord will answer and say unto his people, behold, I will send you corn and wine and oil, and ye shall be satisfied therewith. I will no more make you a reproach among the heathen, but I will remove far off from the northern army and will drive him into the land barren and desolate, with his face towards the east sea and his hinder part towards the utmost sea. And his stink shall come up and his ill savor shall come up, because he hath done great things. Fear not, O land. Be glad and rejoice, for the Lord will do great things. Be not afraid, ye beasts of the field, for the pastures of the wilderness do spring. For the tree beareth her fruit, the fig tree and the vine do yield their strength. Be glad then, ye children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God. For he hath given you the former rain moderately, and he will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain and the latter rain in the first month. And the floor shall be full of wheat, and the fat shall be overflowing with wine and oil. And I will restore to you the years that the locust hath eaten, the cankerworm, and the caterpillar, and the palmworm, my great army which I sent among you. And ye shall eat in plenty and be satisfied, and praise the name of the Lord your God, that hath dwelt wondrously with you, and my people shall never be ashamed. And ye shall know that I am in the midst of Israel, and that I, the Lord your God, and none else, and my people shall never be ashamed. And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. And also upon the servants and upon the handmaidens in those days I will pour out my spirit, and I will show wonders in the heavens and in the earth, blood and fire and pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and the terrible day of the Lord come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be delivered. For in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem shall be deliverance, as the Lord hath said, and in the remnant whom the Lord shall call. For behold, in those days and in that time, when I shall bring again the captivity of Judah and Jerusalem, I will also gather all nations and bring them down into the valley of Jehoshaphat, and will plead with them. I will plead with them there for my people and for my heritage Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations and parted my land. And they have cast lots for my people, and have given a boy for a harlot, and sold a girl for wine that they may drink. Yea, and what have ye to do with me, O Tyre and Sidon, and all the coasts of Palestine? Will ye render me a recompense? If ye recompense me swiftly and speedily, I will return your recompense upon your own head, because ye have taken my silver and my gold, and have carried into your temples my goodly pleasant things. The children also of Judah and the children of Jerusalem have ye sold unto the Grecians, that ye might remove them far from their border. Behold, I will raise them out of the place whither ye have sold them, and will return your recompense upon your own head. And I will sell your sons and your daughters into the hand of the children of Judah, and they shall sell them to the Sabaeans, to a people far off, for the Lord hath spoken it. Proclaim ye among the Gentiles, prepare war, make up the mighty men. Let all the men of war draw near. Let them come up. Beat your plowshares into swords and your pruning hooks into spears. Let the weak say, I am strong. Assemble yourselves and come ye, ye heathen, come all ye heathen and gather yourselves together round about thither, cause thy mighty ones to come down, O Lord. Let the heathen be wakened and come up to the valley of Jehoshaphat, for there will I sit to judge all the heathen round about. Put ye in the sickle, for the harvest is ripe. Come get you down, for the press is full and the fats overflow, for their wickedness is great. Multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision, for the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision. The sun and the moon shall be darkened, and the stars shall withdraw their shining. The Lord also shall roar out of Zion and utter his voice from Jerusalem, and the heavens and the earth shall shake. But the Lord will be the hope of his people and the strength of the children of Israel. So shall ye know that I am the Lord your God, dwelling in Zion, my holy mountain. Then shall Jerusalem be holy, and there shall no strangers pass through her any more. And it shall come to pass in that day that the mountains shall drop down new wine, and the hills shall flow with milk, and the rivers of Judah shall flow with waters, and a fountain shall come forth of the house of the Lord, and shall water the valley of Shittim. Egypt shall be a desolation, and Edom shall be a desolate wilderness, for the violence against the children of Judah, because they have shed innocent blood in their land. But Judah shall dwell forever, and Jerusalem from generation to generation. For I will cleanse their blood that I have not cleansed, for the Lord dwelleth in Zion. Your Father, in Jesus' name, we ask that you give us understanding through the power of your Holy Spirit to understand the words that your Holy Spirit inspired Joel to write. Lord, let us be changed by your word. Let us change the way we think about events, how we think about history, how we think about the way things are around us, and the way we think about our own lifestyle, but especially, Lord, what we think about you. Lord, help us live in the fear of the Lord. Help us truly take you seriously every day, all the time, dear God. In Jesus' name, amen. So last week, I got through a chapter and a half. And to recap, the first part is talking about a horrible locust swarm. And there's some commentators that just want to spiritualize everything. And they say, oh, this is just some kind of army. And because we don't know when Joel did his prophecy, we just look from the context and try to figure out when it was by what's there in the context. It doesn't talk about any king. And because of that, some people think, well, this was the time when Joash was just a child, when all the sons of the previous king were killed by Athaliah, and then she became queen for a while. And then the high priest took him and hid him away. And then when he was 7 years old, then they made him king. And then she was running away, and they didn't kill her till she got outside the temple. And anyway, all that to say, they think that maybe that was the time. It could be. Joel seems to, it is in the grouping of the minor prophets, of the ones that were the earliest of the minor prophets. So this is probably the first prophecy was in Genesis 3, chapter 15. I'll put enmity between thee and the woman, between thy seed and her seed. He shall crush your head, you'll bruise his heel. I mean, that's ancient prophecy talking about Jesus destroying everything that the devil has done. But we got up to the middle of Joel chapter 2, and Joel chapter 1 and the first part of 2 is trying to get everybody to realize this is God, and he's doing something in the land of Israel that is devastating. We don't have a historical account in any of the history in the books of history, 1st and 2nd Samuel, 1st Kings, 1st and 2nd Chronicles. We don't see anything of a locust swarm coming and eating up the land. It doesn't mean it didn't happen. It just means that we don't have that piece of information. But whenever it did happen, God had his prophet Joel write about it. And God is saying, you take this seriously. Well, everything was devastated. All the trees and the plants, everything. And it wiped out everything. So even the wild animals, you know, were mourning and groaning because there wasn't anything for them to eat. So it was the whole area was totally devastated by this locust infestation, the plague of locusts. And God is speaking through Joel and saying, you better take your relationship with God seriously. When things are really good for a long time, we start living for the creature and not the creator. And we start loving the things that God has given us more than God. And we seek the gift and not the giver. So that's the normal thing that happens. And God warned his people about that from the beginning. He says, when you get there and you now are taking over houses that you didn't build and vineyards that you didn't plant and fields that you didn't, and your flocks and your herds and everything's going well, make sure that you don't forget the Lord your God, the one who took you out of the slavery of Egypt and brought you here and gave you this land. And that's true for all of us, because we can get pretty self-absorbed. We can be narcissists in our own little ways, and we're really upset when life becomes inconvenient for us. And that's what's going on right now. We've got, you know, all the crazy stuff as they shut down the world because of COVID and all that. We've got all these businesses that are gone out of business. The world economy is shot. American economy is shot. So as we're seeing this, people who are truly taking things seriously, a lot of them are committing suicide. And even people who call themselves Christians, because a lot of the churches have been closed. You know, it's illegal to do these things and have more than 10 people in a church in California and other places. And people are getting together anyway, and the pastors are saying, forget it, we're going to do what God says. We're not just going to come together, we're going to worship, we're going to sing, even though California says you're not supposed to sing. All those ridiculous things that, you know, the Marxist states out there run by the Democrats are doing. And some of these people, they haven't been interacting in real fellowship with each other, and they're getting to the point of suicide, even Christians. It's very sad. A lot of the suicides are happening because people have lost their businesses. That's the only thing they had their hope in. But people should have peace and serenity with God who are Christians. People should be in the Word. They should receive from the Holy Spirit the words the Holy Spirit inspired directly off the page. You know, we don't need a devotional having some guy who might have some insight, you know, telling us some nice things from the Word. We should just freebase God's Word and read it straight off the page without having somebody tell us about what they think it talks to them about. And we've got every advantage. I mean, you don't have to read it out of King James. You can read it out of New King James or NASB or Holman Christian Standard or something that's easier. You know, some of the other ones I'm not really in favor of, but, you know, you can read it in versions that makes it very simple. I mean, New Living Translation is what, third grade English or something? I mean, there's one that's called Bible in Basic English. You can get it online. And I think it is like a third grade education, and you can read it and understand it very clearly. So there's no excuses for not receiving from God through his holy word. There's no excuses except our own willfulness to say, I don't feel like it. I'd rather be entertained. I'd rather have something that makes me laugh, something that intrigues me. I want something to move my emotions. If you read the Bible, I guarantee your emotions going to be moved. But not only that, your heart is going to be stirred. And you're going to be changed from the inside out. Well, this early prophecy given to God's people, whenever it happened to be, happened because God was going to speak to his people about why he allowed this plague of locusts to destroy his place, his land. The land belongs to God. Mm-hmm. And he gave it to the Jews. He gave it to the children of Israel. And he gave them a much larger chunk of property than they have ever taken possession of. There's going to be a time when they will have full possession of everything God gave them, but it has not happened. There's been times when in the northern tribes reached further than it was during Solomon's time. There's times when the southern tribes reached further than during the time of David and Solomon. So that together they had a bigger piece of property, but they still have not received everything that God says was theirs, that he promised to Abraham. And the promise that he gave Abraham was unconditional. And it had to do with, as long as there's seasons, as long as there's as long as the planet is functioning, this is yours. I've given it to you. It belongs to me. It doesn't belong to all these other characters who decided to live it. Anyway, all that to say, yes, there is a chunk of property that is part of an unconditional promise to the descendants of Abraham through Isaac. Through Isaac. None of the other children of Abraham, who happen to also try to be taken possession. But all that to say, God is calling his people to himself. And when you take all the money out of people's pockets and out of their bank accounts, and all of a sudden they're hungry and they need stuff and they can't get it, all of a sudden people get God's attention. God gets people's attention. I think Luther was the one who said the last thing to get converted when somebody comes to the Lord is their pocketbook. And sometimes that never gets converted. So God has to take matters into his own hands. So here we've got a prophecy that is forcing them to listen to God. So he gets through half of chapter 2, and then he says, starting verse 12, "Therefore also now saith the Lord, turn ye even to me with all your heart, with fasting and with weeping and with mourning. Rend your heart and not your garments, and turn unto the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and of great kindness, and repenteth him of the evil. Who knoweth if he will return and repent and leave a blessing behind him, even a meat offering and a drink offering unto the Lord your God." So here is the main message. Turn to God. God, through Prophet Joel, is saying, turn to me. That's what he's saying. With all your heart. Not most of it. Not parts of it. Not just on Sunday morning. Not just when you're thinking about it. All your heart. And then he says, with fasting, with weeping, with mourning. So we're talking about grieving over your sin, grieving over the distance between you and God, grieving over all those things that have gotten in the way of your relationship with God. And then he says, rend your heart and not your garments. Well, when things were terrible, they would tear their clothes. I mean, it's like an emotional thing. You grab your clothes and you rip them and you let people know the grief that you're under. And it's a humiliating thing to have you walking around with torn clothes. But when you are grieving and you tear your clothes and you let people see the mess, he says, I don't care if anybody knows how grieving is. I don't want you to tear your clothes. Main thing is you tear your heart. I want to see your grief from the inside. It doesn't matter if people think that you're grieving and fasting and mourning on the outside. Rend your heart, not your garments. And then we get this part here, for he is gracious and merciful and slow to anger and of great kindness. And then it says, and repenteth him of the evil, which means God can turn his hand of the destruction that he's doing. He can turn that away. It's kind of like changing his mind, but can God change his mind? No, but the same way that you got the law of gravity, but you also have the law of aerodynamics, a bird should just fall out of the sky and go splat on the ground. But because God gave it wings, gave it the ability to fly, it's flying according to the laws of aerodynamics. And it supersedes the law of the gravity. Same thing as an airplane or a hot air balloon or anything else that now isn't following the law of gravity. Well, there's the law of justice. And God's going to pour out his wrath on those who are wicked. That's like the law of gravity. Whatever raised itself up in proudness against God, it's going to come down. The bigger they are, the harder they fall. But that's actually not true, because they had the thing with the feather and the hammer, and they dropped the boat at the same time, and they both landed, because it's, you know, how fast gravity works. But doesn't matter. You're going to have a bigger splat, because it is a bigger mess, because it's a bigger pile. Anyway, God will turn his hand of either chastisement or punishment away when the other law that supersedes it, which is the law of his mercy, his compassion, the law of his mercy, which is his forgiveness and his grace, and the law of his kindness. It's his kindness that leads us to repentance. And the spiritual law of him being slow to anger. You know, it's, he could have splattered this planet a long time ago, but he is patience. His patience is to usward. He's not willing for any to perish, but all to come to repentance. He doesn't want people to get what they deserve. That's why he became a human being, lived the perfect life in our place, and then died on the cross for what we deserved, so that whoever would believe in him will not perish, but have eternal life. This is who our God is. And then verse 14, who knoweth if he will return and repent? Who knows if God will see true repentance and hold back his hand of destruction? And then leave a blessing behind him. Well, that's what he does. You know, I want to take you back to New Testament, 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, that's the word homologeo. It means to say the same. When we say what God says about who we are and about our sin and about our acts of rebellion against the holy God, if we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to what? Forgive us of our sin and cleanse us of all of our unrighteousness. When we have confessed our sin and told God what God's been telling us, when we finally own the guilt of what we've done and say, yeah, I did it, and I am that wicked person. I am that wretch. I am that sinner. I am the one who is a rebel against you. When we own it and not have excuses, not say it's my folks or not say it's my whoever, or not, you know, not have any kind of excuses, at that point, now he is going to be faithful and just to forgive us. How can he forgive us? Because he paid the price himself. He was punished in our place. So he can forgive, because he was punished in our place. And then he also cleanses. The blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all of our sin. So it's not just, okay, I won't, you know, I paid the debt, so you don't have to pay it anymore, but I'm watching you. I know who you are. I know what you've done. He does. There's no shame with God. It doesn't matter who or what or whatever. It's not like a stupid 12-step program when you stand in front of everybody and you admit the shame of whatever sin that you're into. No, there is no 12-step program. That's all demonic. And it comes from people who are listening to demons, by the way. Even though people have tried to add a bunch of God's word to it and say, celebrate recovery, they're still using a demonic program that holds your sinful pride intact. And it gives you something else to be addicted to instead of whatever drug or bad activity or you know, behavior that you're into. No, one step. Come to Jesus Christ. Confess your sin to him. He is faithful and just to forgive you of your sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. He doesn't hold that shame in your identity of whatever sin you is. No, he cleanses you with the whole precious blood. So when he looks at you, he doesn't see his sin. He sees the blood of his son, Jesus, that's taken away your sin. Not the sin of all these whole, you know, these poor innocent animals who had to be slain and just covered sin. No, Jesus Christ, he takes away the sin of the world. The Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. It's gone. It's not there. God doesn't see it. Anyway, all I have to say, that's our God. gracious and merciful, slow to anger, of great kindness, he repenteth him of evil. It means if you have asked him to forgive you because of what Jesus did on the cross for you, he will. And what's the result? You're not going to get what you deserve because Jesus took it in your place. Does he change his mind? Not really. Because he made provision for both. Either justice is done. It's either done because we are going to get paid for our deeds. According to our works, we're going to be judged. It says that over and over again in the Bible. Or when we place our faith in Jesus Christ, then Jesus got punished for our sins in our place. Verse 14, who knoweth if he will return or repent? Well, who knoweth? How do we know? Maybe he will. Well, if Israel repented, and obviously they did at this point, God withheld his hand and God once again blessed them. And God will again bless them because this prophecy is a prophecy. And it's not just what happened there, but what happened there was getting their attention to focus on the future and what's going to happen. Who knoweth if he will return or repent and leave a blessing behind him? Even a meat offering and drink offering unto the Lord. So a meat offering and drink offering, now that means that the priests themselves are once again going to receive their pay, so to speak. Because they didn't have an inheritance. They didn't have a piece of property. They could have a farm and take care of themselves. No, they were dependent on all the offerings that came in as they worshiped the Lord according to how God had directed it. Okay. Blow the trumpet in Zion, sanctify a fast, call a solemn assembly. Well, that word trumpet isn't something neat and pretty and silver and, you know, or whatever, you know, whoever your favorite trumpet player is. It's, you can just name some, you know, Louis Armstrong, Ziggy Elman, you know, Big Spiderback, you know, those are the old guys. No, this is the Hebrew word is shofar. And this is a shofar. It's a ram's horn. Yeah, hold your ears. So, blow a trumpet in Zion. Well, when you blow a trumpet in Zion, that means that this is what's going to be blown when there's a war coming. Which means you're on the wall and you're blowing it because the enemy is on its way, so you better be prepared. They will also blow the shofar on the Feast of Trumpets, which is Rosh Hashanah, first day of the year. And it happens in the fall. So it's what, 2 weeks away? 2 weeks away. So I'm going to blow this 2 weeks ahead. You know, it's, you know, if you look at all the different the feasts of Israel, there's a really good chance that Jesus would come back on Rosh Hashanah. That would be great. 2 weeks to come back. That would be wonderful. I wish that would be the case. Lord Jesus, come quickly. Be wonderful. And I don't care if the Democrats take over because we're home, you know. No, anyway. All right. We're going to blow a trumpet in Zion. Trumpet in Zion, sanctify a fast, not a feast, you know, a fast. Which means everybody's going to get together and not eat something. Call a solemn assembly. Gather the people, sanctify the congregation, assemble the others, gather the children and those that suck the breast. Let the bridegroom go forth of his chamber and the bride out of his closet. Let the priests and the ministers of the Lord weep between the porch and the altar and let them say, spare thy people, O Lord. And give not thine heritage to reproach that the heathen should rule over them. Wherefore should they say among the people, where is their God? So that's everybody. Nobody's excluded. Kids aren't, you know, having a nice little daycare and children's ministry somewhere. No, they're all together. Everybody is together. Nobody's to be excluded. Even the people who just got married. You know, there was somebody getting married here, and I happened to tell them, Jesus would come today. You know, it's like, I don't think it was a really good time for them to think about the rapture could happen before I get married. No, this is even more important. It's just, of all the things, now is the time to really turn to the Lord. Not pay attention to yourself, even with the food that your body wants and is craving. What happens when people repent? When they truly turn their heart to the Lord? God will hear. And God will bless. God will withhold his hand of judgment, or he'll rescue the people who are praying and repenting from the judgment to come. Who knoweth if he will return and repent and leave a blessing behind him? Who knows? You know, I have to go to a passage that's horribly abused. I just have to go there. And you hear it all the time, and they always have it, you know, for National Day of Prayer, blah, blah, blah. And 1 Chronicles 7, right? Okay, 1 Chronicles 7. I'm going to start from verse 12. So Solomon did this beautiful thing. I mean, huge numbers of cattle were sacrificed, and all kinds of things were happening. Everybody was there worshiping. It was the most amazing worship festival feast that you could imagine. And Solomon prayed. Verse 12, and the Lord appeared to Solomon by night and said unto him, I have heard thy prayer and have chosen this place to myself for an house of sacrifice. If I shut up heaven that there be no rain, or if I command the locusts to devour the land, or if I send pestilence among my people, if my people which are called by my name shall do what? Humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and I will heal their land. This is conditional. This is not unconditional. Humble themselves. I mean, I've listened to or watched some of the National Day of Prayer stuff, and I see some pretty arrogant buffoons up there thinking they're talking to God. They're not humble before God. Some of those guys, it doesn't look like they fasted a day in their life. Humble themselves and pray. Well, how are you going to pray? Well, number one, you can't have any sin in your life. You have to have already confessed everything and turned from it, or God won't listen to it. You have to be on really good terms with your wife, because if you're not loving her and understanding that she's a co-heir in heaven and living with her in an understanding way, God's not going to answer your prayers. He's going to go, la, 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 I'm not listening to you because you're not taking care of my daughter. I'm not going to listen to anything you have to say. Some of these guys who are up there praying the National Day of Prayer have had affairs. It's like, is God going to listen to these characters? Of course not. Whatever they did in their buffoonery up there in front of everybody to make a big show of how wonderful and religious they are, God didn't hear a single word. If my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face, are they really seeking God's face? Or are they relying on their systematic theology, taking things out of contract text and saying what how they want the Bible to read? And are they turning from their wicked ways? Is it true repentance? Are they truly turning from their wicked ways? Which means all the money that they took from the congregation to buy their couple extra houses and their boats or their whatever, have they turned from that wicked way? Have they sent the money that came in for certain ministries to those specific ministries that they said was going to go to? Then will I hear from heaven and forgive their sin and heal their land. Now mine eyes shall be open and my ears attent unto the prayer that is made in this place. That's the temple. For now I have chosen and sanctified this house that my name may be there forever, and mine eyes, my heart, shall be there perpetually. And as for thee, if thou wilt walk before me as David thy father walked, do according to all that I have commanded thee, and shalt observe my statutes and my judgments, then will I establish the throne of thy kingdom according as I have covenanted with David thy father, saying, there shall not fail thee a man to be ruler in Israel. Did Solomon do that? No. And it was conditional. There's an if there. And so Rehoboam lost most of the kingdom. But if ye turn away and forsake my statutes and my commandments, which I have set before you, and shall go and serve other gods and worship them, then I will pluck them up by the roots out of my land, which I have given them, and this house, which I have sanctified for my name, and I will cast out of my sight, and will make it to be a proverb and a byword among the nations. And this house, which is high, shall be an astonishment to everyone that passeth by it, so that he will say, why hath the Lord done this unto his land and unto his house? And it shall be answered, because they forsook the Lord their God of their fathers, which brought them forth of the land of Egypt, and laid hold on other gods, and worshipped them and served them. Therefore hath he brought all this evil upon them. But I want to say, the original context of this 2 Chronicles 7:14 is talking to Israelis seeking the Lord in Solomon's temple. That's the original context. And we try to somehow make it seem like, you know, America is one nation under God. Well, it's never been. Be nice if it was. But there's only one theocracy that's ever been, and that's Israel. It's the only theocracy. Because how many people in Washington ever listen to God's word? Or do what his word says? You know, nobody I ever voted for did that. You know, a couple people might be Christians, but anyway, very sad. I just want to say that because this thing is taken out of context, and somebody will just throw up a 2 Chronicles 2:14. Oh, in the last years, and oh yeah, my people just called by my name. Well, put it back in its context. Stop spiritualizing the Bible. And if you're going to take that literally, then we better be in Jerusalem praying. Well, there's a place, part of the retaining wall of Herod's temple, called the Wailing Wall, that's holding up some of the extra earth that he put in to make the temple on a higher area, about 60 feet higher than it was. People still go there and pray. They let you in. Can't bring a Bible. Anyway, so if people do repent, if they have rent their hearts, if they have turned to the Lord, then God, who is gracious and merciful and slow to anger and of great kindness, will turn away from the judgment that he had planned. Verse 18. Of chapter 2. Then will the Lord be jealous for his land and pity his people. Yea, the Lord will answer and say to his people, behold, I will send you corn and wine and oil, and ye shall be satisfied therewith. And I will no longer make a reproach unto the heathen, but I will remove far off from you the northern army, and will drive away into the land of land barren and desolate, with the face towards the east sea, and his hinder part towards the utmost sea, and his stink shall come up as his ill savor shall come up, because he hath done great things. Well, the main thing that was happening at this point was a swarm of locusts that ate up the land. And obviously, because Israel survived it, they turned and repented. And God sent those locusts away, and they were drowned in the sea and stunk it up. That's the real context here. But it also is prophecy, and it prophesies the enemies of Israel. Well, the enemies of Israel come from the north. There's a couple of them that had, obviously, the first one that took away the northern tribes was Assyria. And the one that took away Judah into captivity for 7 years is Babylon. But they all came from the north. But there'll be another. Gog and Magog, Meshach, all these things. If you go straight north from where Israel is, you're going to run into Moscow if you go far enough north. Yeah. So there's going to be, you know, there's going to be more. And according to prophecy, God will also destroy them. But the first one was just the bugs that were eating up everything. But they did as much damage as any other kind of nation. And what's interesting, when he calls these locusts, he calls them a people. And that's the word goyim, goy, which means, you know, the same word that's used for a Gentile, a non-Jewish person. Quite interesting. Okay, verse 21. Fear not, O land, be glad and rejoice, for the Lord will do great things. Be not afraid, ye beasts of the field, for the pastures of the wilderness do spring. For the tree beareth her fruit, the fig tree and the vine do yield their strength. Be glad then, ye children of Zion, rejoice in the Lord your God, for he hath given you the former rain moderately, and he will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain and the latter rain in the first month. So to understand former and latter, we have to understand the Jewish calendar. It's going to start again in a couple of weeks. That's the beginning of the year. You know, in our way of thinking, we have this Gregorian calendar, whatever. It starts off in January 1. Well, they don't have it that way. So when we think former latter, we actually got them the other way around. So I like to say. But people take this out of context, and you have what's called the latter rain movement. And if you look at the context, you will see a connection between the rain and living waters and streams with the Holy Spirit. There is a connection here, and we'll see that. But they take this and make the whole thing turn into something else. You know, we've got Joel's army. Well, who's Joel's army? It's these grasshoppers who are eating up the land. It's pretty weird. You know, I mean, blow a trumpet in Zion, it talks about these grasshoppers that are eating up the landscape. They run like, you know, jump over walls and carrying on. I'm sorry, you know, you could take something out of context and make it mean something else. Now people are saying that they are going to be running on the walls and doing all these great feats, which is what? Destroying the land of Israel. But the, you know, manifest sons of destiny and all these kinds of things. It's first off, it's number one, it's replacement theology, which means God took all his promises to Israel and rejected Israel, gave all the promises to the church. So it mutilates the whole idea of the church in Israel and all that stuff. They never read Romans 9-11 or understood it. They never understood it. So it does that first off. And then it's basically post-millennial, which means everybody's going to do all this work. We're going to be, you know, army and strength, and we're going to do all these great things for God, and we're going to conquer the world for Jesus Christ, and then he'll come and rule and reign. No, that's not what the Bible says. Why do you stick with what the Bible says? But what they say is, well, if we do this, then the book of Revelation doesn't have to be that way. You know, the New Agers do the same thing. They say, well, you know, if we all get together and unify, then, you know, the book of Revelation, everything it predicts, it, you know, that won't have to happen. Really. Either got God, the Holy Spirit, or you. Who are you going to believe? I mean, really. Come on. So he's going to bring the rain, former and the latter rains. There's basically the rainy season happens in what we call the spring and what we call the fall. The fall is the beginning of the year. And so it makes it so that you can till the soil. And the first thing that you're growing is going to be barley. And that's the first harvest. Then comes the wheat harvest. And then you have the latter rains, which is the spring rains. And that's what keeps the wheat growing and ready. So then comes the next harvest, which is in the spring of the wheat. Okay. Well, it says, and the floor shall be full of wheat, and the vats shall be overflowing with wine and oil. And I will restore to you the years that the locusts had eaten. And then they use these different words. And basically, there's just four different words in the Hebrew, which either are describing four different kinds of grasshoppers, and I personally think that's the case, because just in the state of Arizona, we have about 250 different kinds of grasshoppers. So I, you know, in the Middle East, it's the same they have. And in the Hebrew, I mean, if you go through the Bible, there's got to be like, I don't know, maybe a dozen, more than a dozen different words for grasshoppers in the Bible, just in the Hebrew. So anyway, there's only four ones here. Some people say, well, this is just the four stages of growth of a grasshopper. Yeah, it could be, but I think it's, you know, different bugs that are showing up to eat what's left and what just recently sprouted from the last one, and some of them will eat even the bark off the trees, and that's what it talks about here. And ye shall eat in plenty and be satisfied, and praise the name of the Lord your God that hath dwelt wondrously with you, and my people shall never be ashamed, and ye shall know that I am in the midst of Israel, and that I am the Lord your God, and none else, and my people shall never be ashamed. And it shall come to pass afterwards that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions, and also upon the servants and upon the handmaidens in those days I will pour out my spirit. And I will show wonders in the heavens and the earth, and blood and fire and pillars of smoke, and the sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and the terrible day of the Lord come. And it shall come to pass that whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be delivered. For in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem shall be deliverance, as the Lord hath said, and in the remnant whom the Lord shall call. Bunch of stuff there. So there is a connection in the picture of the rains coming. Well, the rains come so that all the crops, your fig trees and your grapevines and your wheat and all those things, plus all everything you need to feed your animals, all this is happening. So now everything is once again prosperous. So now all the wild animals are now reproducing, and all everybody in the whole land is once again healed and growing and so on. And they will never again be disappointed or be ashamed, because nothing is working. Now there's success. Now they're getting blessing upon blessing. Verse 28, and it shall come to pass afterwards that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Pour out my spirit on all flesh. Now, I just want to read one thing, because there was somebody called Moses who had that same idea. So in Numbers chapter 11, starting verse 24, if you remember, he had talked to his brother-in-law, his father-in-law, and his father-in-law had come to visit all these people there in the wilderness, and he says, what you're doing is not good. You're wearing yourself out, and the people have to wait too long for justice. You know, this, you need to divide up this responsibility of judging all these cases. So he prayed over it, and he says, what is good? You know, this is a good idea. So they chose all these elders, and then God said, okay, assemble all the elders, and they're all going to go up to the mountain with Moses. And they all saw God and ate with him. So this is an amazing thing. Okay, so verse 24, Numbers 11. So Moses went out and told the people the words of the Lord, and he gathered the 70 men and the elders of the people and placed them around the tabernacle. And the Lord came down in the cloud and spoke to him and took of the spirit that was upon him and placed the same upon the 70 elders. And it happened when the Spirit rested upon them that they prophesied, although they never did it again so. But two of the men remained in the camp. The name of one was Eldad, and the name of the other Medad. And the Spirit rested upon them. Now they were among those listed, but who had not gone out to the tabernacle, yet they prophesied in the camp. And a young man ran and told Moses and said, Eldad and Medad are prophesying in the camp. So Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' assistant, one of the choice men, answered and said, Moses, my Lord, forbid them. Then Moses said to him, are you zealous or jealous for my sake? Oh, that all the Lord's people were prophets, and that the Lord would put his spirit upon them. And Moses returned to the camp, he and the elders of Israel. Oh, that all of the Lord's people were prophets. I would save Moses a whole lot of work. I mean, he's got to talk to God for every single inconvenience, every single complaint, every single conflict, every kind of thing that's going on. He's just, and there's just miles of people waiting to get talked to, and y'all got to get through Moses to get to God to get his answer. And he says, oh, you know, this would be amazing, you know, that all the Lord's people were prophets and that the Lord would put his spirit on them. Beautiful. Well, what does this prophecy say? I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. Also upon the servants. That means the slaves. People were owned by other people. Upon the handmaidens in those days, I will pour out my spirit. Yeah, it's going to do that. This is not the only place where this is prophesied. Isaiah 12:3, therefore, you will joyously draw water from the springs of salvation. Isaiah 32, verse 15. Until the Spirit is poured out from us from on high, and the wilderness becomes a fertile field, and the fertile field is considered as a forest. Isaiah 44, verse 3. For I will pour out water on the thirsty land, and streams on the dry ground, and I will pour out my Spirit on your offerings, and my blessings on your descendants. Ezekiel 36, 26. Moreover, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you, and I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. 27. I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will be careful to observe my ordinances. 37, verse 14. I will put my spirit within you, and you will come to life, and I will place you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken and done it, declares the Lord. Isaiah 40, verse 5, the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all flesh will see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken it. Zechariah 12, 10, how about this one? I'll pour out on the house of David and on the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and of supplication, so that they will look on me, whom they have pierced, and they will mourn for him as one who mourns for a son, and they will weep bitterly over him, like the bitter weeping of a firstborn. When did this happen? Well, it didn't happen right away. It didn't happen for a long time. We get a man on the scene called John the Baptist. Matthew 3:11. As for me, John says, I baptize you with water for repentance. But he who is coming after me is mightier than I, and I am not fit to remove his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will thoroughly clear his threshing floor. He will gather his wheat into the barn, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. See the same thing in Luke 3, 16 and 17. Jesus is on the scene, and John is talking about Jesus. And John 1:33, John says, I did not recognize him, but he who sent me to baptize in water said to me, he upon whom you see the Spirit descend and remain upon, this is the one who baptizes in the Holy Spirit. John 3:5, Jesus answered Nicodemus and said, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. John 4:10, talking to the woman at the well, Jesus answered her, if you knew the gift of God and who says to you, give me a drink, you would have given him, and he would have given you living water. Verse 14, but whoever drinks of the water that I will give him shall never thirst, but the water that I will give him will become in him a well of water springing up to eternal life. John 6:63, it is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and they are life. John 7:37. Now, on the last day of the great feast, Jesus stood and cried out, saying, if anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. For he who believes in me, as the Spirit says, from his innermost being will flow rivers of living water. But he spoke of the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were to receive. For the Spirit was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. So then Jesus in the upper room, after Judas had left, John 14, verse 16, I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may be with you forever. That is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it does not see him or know him. But you know him because he abides with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. After a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me because I live. You will live also. Verse 26 of John 14. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to remembrance all that I said to you. John 16, verse 7. But I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, then the Helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. In John 11, verse 13. Not John, Luke 11, verse 13. Luke gives us this thing from Jesus, the only place we find it. Jesus says, if you then, it's a parable about prayer and how to pray. And he says, if you then being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give you the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Luke 24, verse 49. Behold, I am sending forth the promise of my Father upon you, but you are to stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high. Acts 1, this is Luke, second book, Acts 1, verse 4. Gathering them together, he commanded them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait the Father, what the Father had promised, which he said, you heard of me, what you heard from me. Verse 5, for John baptized with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So when they had come together, they were asking him, saying, Lord, is it at this time you are restoring the kingdom to Israel? He said to them, it is not for you to know the times of the epochs which the Father has fixed by his own authority, but you will receive power from the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses both in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and even to the remotest part of the earth. Acts chapter 2, verse 2. And suddenly there came from heaven a noise like a violent rushing wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. And there appeared to them tongues as of fire, distributing themselves, and they rested on each one of them. And they were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit was giving them utterance. Verse 14. But Peter, taking his stand with the 11, raised his voice and declared to them, Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and give heed to my words. For these men are not drunk as you suppose, for it is only the third hour of the day. But this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. And it shall be in the last days, God says, that I will pour forth of my spirit on all mankind, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your own old men shall dream dreams. And even on my bondslaves, both men and women, I will in those days pour forth of my spirit, and they shall prophesy, and I will grant wonders in the sky above and signs in the earth below, blood and fire and vapor of smoke, and the sun will be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and glorious day of the Lord shall come, and it shall be that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. That's the last few verses of chapter 2 of Joel. Verse 33 of Acts 2, therefore, having been exalted to the right hand of God and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured forth this which you both see and hear. Verse 38, Peter said to them, you know, they were cut to the heart. He preached to 3,000 people who saw this amazing event and they didn't know what was going on. And he preached to them, preaching the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Preaching that Jesus is the Messiah, God the Son, who rose from the dead. And they were cut to the heart. So verse 38 of Acts chapter 2, Peter said to them, repent each one of you and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and your children, and for all who are afar off, and as many as the Lord our God will call to himself. That includes us. That includes us. So this is the original place. There was another thing, obviously, in the upper room where Jesus appeared to the disciples. Thomas wasn't there. And he breathed on them. And he says, receive the Holy Spirit. And then he says the scriptures were opened up to them. So obviously they received the Holy Spirit when Jesus breathed to them and said, receive it. But what we see in Acts chapter 2 is God's Holy Spirit coming upon these 120 people who were there. And they spoke in 17 different languages. And the people who were gathered for the Feast of Pentecost, Shavuot, the Feast of Weeks, that was when they were going to bring in the first of the harvest. They all heard the glorious things that God had done in their own mother tongue, not in Hebrew. Quite interesting. So Acts chapter 2 is the big event, but we see the Holy Spirit over and over again in the book of Acts showing that he is fulfilling this prophecy when it says and it will come to pass afterwards that I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, which means not just the Jews. Well, in Acts 31, this was after Peter and John had gotten beat up, after the man got healed at the beautiful gate and so on. They kept preaching. They told him not to preach. And they said, we can't help but to speak about what we've seen and heard, and there is no salvation given unto men, given to whereby we must be saved. The name of Jesus Christ. You have to believe in Jesus Christ or you can't be saved. So anyway, so they get back together, Acts 4:31. And when they had prayed, the place where they had gathered together was shaken. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit. And what did they do? They spoke the word of God with boldness. That's what they did. They boldly proclaimed the word of God. They boldly continued to preach in Jesus' name what they were commanded not to do. Civil disobedience. They'd rather obey God rather than men. Well, then, God decides to send... A few years later, he's going to send the Holy Spirit to the Gentiles. Acts 10:44, while Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit fell upon all those who were listening to the message. All the circumcised believers who came with Peter were amazed because the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out on the Gentiles also, for they were hearing them speaking with tongues and exalting God. And Peter answered, surely no one can refuse the water for these to be baptized who have received the Holy Spirit, just as we did. And then in Acts 11, he gives the same story to the other people in Jerusalem who are going, what are you going into some Gentile's house for and what are you doing that for? And as Peter is now defending this, when we get to Acts chapter 15, what are you going to do with these Gentiles who are believing? Peter stood up and said to them, brethren, you know that the early days God made a choice among you that by my mouth the Gentiles will hear the word of God and the God will hear the word of the gospel and believe. And God, who knows the heart, testified to them, giving them the Holy Spirit just as he also did to us. So the Holy Spirit is given to all flesh. Doesn't matter if you're a Jew or a Gentile. There's a previous story of, after the stoning of Stephen, and one of the seven deacons continued to evangelize, and he went into Samaria, and there was like a big revival going on. All these Samaritans were getting saved, and so Peter and John come to Samaria, and they lay hands on people, and the Samaritans are now also receiving the Holy Spirit. So there is, the Holy Spirit is now to everyone, coming to everyone. I just had left that one out, I forgot. So all that to say, this was fulfilled, but not until after Jesus came, paid the price for the sin of the world, rose from the dead, and then ascended into heaven and sent his Holy Spirit as this promise was fulfilled. And for the first 10 years of the church's life, it was mostly Jewish, almost all Jewish. And then finally, the word of God goes to the Gentiles, the non-Jewish believers. Well, it went to the Samaritans, obviously, and then it went to the believers, the Gentile believers. So we can understand how this got fulfilled. But as I said before, there is, in prophecy, it's a pattern. We get this idea, okay, here's this prophecy, and it gets, here's the fulfillment. But prophecy and fulfillment, it goes beyond that. That's the pattern. The picture was done because there was the locust who did the infestation, and then God says, I'm going to send the rain as it's supposed to come. And then the plants will once again grow, and you'll have plenty of grain, and you'll have plenty of grapes, and you'll have plenty of cattle, all those kinds of things. And that's a picture for the Holy Spirit coming. Well, there was a huge amount of time, 400 years, where God didn't say anything to his people, where God's people had been, you know, after the Babylonians and was taken over by the Medes and Persians and was taken over by, you know, the Persian Empire was pretty long. And then it was taken over by the Greeks. And then it was taken over by the Romans. And then God sends Jesus. After the time when Jesus did his ministry, then he sends his Holy Spirit. So that is the beginning of the church. But this is also a partial fulfillment. But we're talking about the land of Israel. The Holy Spirit goes to all flesh, which means, yeah, we're right now in the parentheses. We're in this area where God is now dealing with Gentiles. But he's going to once again deal with the Jews. Well, you can go to the book of Ezekiel, and you're going to talk about that vision, the valley of dry bones. And he says, preach to those bones. And bones come together, and they get flesh. But they're still dead. And God pours his Spirit on those dead bodies. That is going to be what's going to happen next. And the Jews will be saved. But that's going to happen during the period of time that is dedicated to the Jews, which is going to be called the time of Jacob's trouble, which is also called the tribulation period, where the Jews, the nation of Israel, is now getting God's focus. And as they get God's focus, they once again are going to get something even worse than this locust infestation. They're going to get nations coming against them, nations from the north. Got the Gog and Magog infestation. And you will also see another one that I believe is separate, and that's called Armageddon. So we're going to continue on with this as we go here. So we talk about all these things, and we have the promise of the Holy Spirit. What comes right after the promise of the Holy Spirit? Verse 30 of Joel chapter 2. And I will show wonders in the heavens and the earth, blood and fire and pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon blood before the great and the terrible day of the Lord. And it shall come to pass on whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be delivered. For in Mount Zion and Jerusalem shall be deliverance. Well, Peter read that. You know, when he started preaching, he's preaching from the end of Joel 2. And he talks about, okay, what you're seeing is the Holy Spirit coming down and filling all flesh. Well, it wasn't all flesh, not for another 10 years before the Gentiles finally received the Holy Spirit. But it's the beginning of God pouring out his Holy Spirit. But what about the second thing that Peter is talking about? The verses are right here. He read them. Did it happen then? I will show wonders in the heavens and the earth, blood and fire and pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon blood. Has that happened yet? Hasn't happened yet. That's still to come. When there's a prophecy, things are what you say are telescopic. So when you went to Flagstaff or somewhere, you went to Prescott, and you're coming down I-17, just pretend it's a clear day. And you're coming down back into the valley, and what do you see? You see the valley. You start seeing the city. Things are there. And then in the middle of the valley seems like one big mountain, right? But as you keep coming down I-17, it's not one big mountain. You're going to see some other mountains, and you're going to realize, oh, well, that's, it's separated. There's North Mountain. There's Pinnacle Peak. There's North Mountain. There's Shaw Butte. There's Squaw Peak. There's Camelback, Papago Bluffs. And then as you go down, you realize, oh, there's, you know, Superstition Mountains. But when you're coming down from I-17 from Sunset Point, it looks like one mountain in the valley. But the closer you get, the more those things that you saw from a distance are separated from each other. Here you got a couple of verses talking about God pouring out his Holy Spirit on all flesh. Did that happen all at once? No, it's still happening. With every single person who placed their faith in Jesus Christ, they receive the Holy Spirit. They become part of the church. But we haven't gotten this part yet. I will show wonders in the heavens and the earth and blood and fire and pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon by blood. Oh, but didn't last year we have that tetrad of blood moon thing? 2 years ago, whatever craziness was. You know what? Nobody called them blood moons until these characters who were talking about blood moons came up with it. And when they had these tetrad of so-called blood moons, at best they kind of looked scab-like. They weren't blood red. I wasn't impressed, you know. And not all of them were looking like a blood moon in Jerusalem. A lot of them never showed up that way, you know. Anyway, all I'll say, it was just a bunch of nonsense of people who are, you know, histrionics to try to get people to buy their books and support their ministry and all that kind of stuff. And the same people who were doing that, they say we're already in tribulation. Well, sorry. If that's the case, they were left behind. Too bad for them. Anyway. No, the sun should be turned into darkness and the moon blood. Well, when does that happen? What happens as the seal judgments, as Jesus takes the seals off the scroll, and then those things start happening. And when he starts taking the first couple of seals off, well, it just seems like different political things. And it seems like, okay, well, there's pestilence and there's plague and there's, you know, then you've got wars and you've got all these different things, you know, the different things that can go on historically, but still worse than ever known in the history of man, until finally you get to the point where all of a sudden now hell is breaking loose on the earth and all kinds of things are happening, earthquakes and all kinds of famines, and you've got wormwood coming down, and you know, you got destruction of the ability to drink the water that's on the planet. All kinds of horrible things are happening. When these catastrophic events, cataclysmic events happen, are you going to be able to see the sun? It's going to be clouded up by all the dust and smoke and everything else in the atmosphere. I mean, when you got, you know, all these forests are all burning at the same time, and you got just the California fires we had some really pretty sunsets, you know. We had a really pretty moon last night, one of those full corn moon, harvest moon things. Some kind of dummy in the gut for all different full moons. Anyway, whatever that is, it was real pretty. Why? Because there's still lots of smoke in the air from the California fires. It is nothing in comparison to what will happen when God pours out his wrath. And if he didn't cut those days short, no human life would survive it. So we ain't seen nothing yet. I will show wonders in the heavens and the earth, blood and fire, pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and moon and blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord. And it shall come to pass that whoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be delivered. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Well, Peter talked about that. Paul in chapter 10 of Romans, whoever calls the name of the Lord will be saved. And all those JWs that come to your door, they don't believe that Yahweh is ever translated into the word Kyrios in Greek. But when you take an Old Testament passage, it uses Yahweh, Jehovah God, that word, the tetragrammaton in the Hebrew, and you're quoting that verse, and that word gets translated for the word for the Lord. Last guy who was here, I said, hey, you look it up. There's plenty of times in the New Testament where Kyrios is translating the word Yahweh. But he had to get away. He didn't like it. Plus, I had a cross in the front yard that says the Telstai on it. He didn't like that either. Anyway, I think he was intrigued by the Israeli flag in the front yard. You know, so, oh, maybe I can get a Jew to come to. Oh, man, what a mess. Anyway, and it shall come to pass, whoever shall call upon the name of Yahweh Jehovah God, L-O-R-D capitalized, shall be saved. And that's the way it is now. Whoever calls the name of the Lord will be saved. And it's going to happen during the tribulation period when all hell is breaking loose on this planet, when God is pouring out his wrath on a Christ-rejecting world, as he is purifying the Jews and bring them to a place where they will place their faith back into their God, into Yahweh, Jehovah God. For in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem shall be deliverance, as the Lord had said, and in the remnant whom the Lord shall call. That word Zion doesn't really show up in the Bible until Psalms. It actually shows up in like 2 Samuel. Well, Zion is kind of the name of part of where the temple was built, which was the threshing floor that David bought. And it's the same place that Abraham came to sacrifice Isaac, Mount Moriah. And it got the name somehow Zion. And so sometimes the name of the city of Jerusalem, they'll use that name Zion. Sometimes it's just that part of Jerusalem. Sometimes it's the name of the temple. They'll use that word Zion. So I just want to say, the word Zion is never used for heaven. But if you are a replacement theology, which means God rejected Israel, gave all Israel's provinces to the church, then you say Zion is heaven. Because every time you see Jerusalem, you're just thinking heaven. Or every time you see Israel, it's talking about heaven or the church. No, look up the word Israel in a Strong's Concordance and find out how many times that it means heaven. It don't. Really. I mean, come on. Or does it mean the church? It never means the church, rather. Or Jerusalem. There's only one time when Jerusalem means heaven. It's called the New Jerusalem. That comes down, you have to take the words in context. But if you're going to spiritualize stuff, you're going to make the Bible say whatever you want it to say. Really, anybody can show up then and say, well, this is what the Bible says. Why? Because if you're going to allegorize Scripture, now Scripture allegory came out of the Gnostics, came from North Africa. And it got absorbed into the church through Origen. Origen was great for all kinds of spiritualizing or allegorizing. Augustine took it over and kept it as part of the practice. And then people who, there was a reformation in the church, right? People were reading the Bible for themselves, but they come from an Augustinian background. Both Calvin and Luther were Augustinian in their theology. And so they just naturally allegorized things. It wasn't until people had the Bible in their own language and could read it, like you're reading a newspaper, where allegory finally was kind of put to rest. But in the majority of Christianity, we're talking about 90% of Christianity, they still allegorize the Scriptures. They still spiritualize it, and they don't take it literally. Anyway. I say that because Zion means Jerusalem, the place on the planet. And as we read that section from 2 Chronicles, God promised Solomon, he is going to be there, his presence is going to be there. That's where he chose his name to be. And then he said what word? Forever.
Amen.
That's a really nice word, forever. Because we're thinking about living eternally. We're going to live in heaven forever, right? We're going to live with Jesus forever. Well, if it only means for extended period of time, then we're going to go up to heaven and only be there for extended period of time. Come on. If you're going to believe the Bible, you got to believe all the Bible and take it literally, take it in context. You know, just look at it in context where, I'm sorry, it just drives me crazy. But I grew up in that way of thinking. And you just, and if you look at the Bibles, I mean, in your, my wife's got a Thompson's Chain reference, right? And even in some of the translations, like ESV and stuff, if you look in reading through like Isaiah or whatever, it'll say the church. Church is never mentioned in the Old Testament. Why should it be on a heading above a chapter in Isaiah? I mean, come on, give me a break. What's the matter with you people? But because of replacement theology, they've just taken it and flopped it off backwards. Sorry. You're interpreting the Bible poorly. Don't interpret it according to what you've been told, according to the hoops that you were forced to give an oath to continue to spew forth as a Lutheran pastor. No, read it literally. There was a Lutheran pastor who read the book of Revelation and took it seriously and took it literally. His name was Seiss, you know, and he wrote a really good literal commentary of the Bible. That was over 100 years ago. Anyway, not like a whole Lutheran would have to do that, but anyway. Well, the sun and the moon grow dark, the stars elude their brightness. This is in Joel 3:15. So I just want to continue on in Joel 3. So now he's gone from the promise of the Holy Spirit. Now the promise of what? Destruction of the planet. That's a promise. I don't see that in my little promise book that I got in the back. Anyway. For behold, in those days and in that time, I shall bring again the captivity of Judah to Jerusalem. When did that happen? Well, that happened through Ezra and Nehemiah. But at the time of the writing of Joel, the Assyrians and the Babylonians hadn't taken any Jews into captivity yet. But it's a prophecy. God already knew they were going to be taken into captivity. Verse 2, I'll also gather the nations, I'll bring them down to the valley of Jehoshaphat, and I will plead with them for my people and for my heritage Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations and parted my land. Okay. I'm going to gather all the nations in the valley of Jehoshaphat. Where's the valley of Jehoshaphat? If you look in your Bibles, you might find it in the maps. But the Bible never tells you where it is, because I don't think it's a place. I don't think it's a place, because Jehoshaphat means the Lord will judge. The Lord's going to judge. There is a valley where the Lord is going to judge. So some people, and you'll see it on some maps, they'll have a valley of Jehoshaphat, and it's right there in the Kidron Valley. So where's the Kidron? You know, so here's the temple. And Jesus walked down to Brook Kidron. He went back up the other side to the Mount of Olives. It's not like a gigantic valley where you're going to have everybody there.
Is this where the writing our names in the Book of Life?
No, something else. So there isn't any place that's called the Valley of Jehoshaphat. But Jehoshaphat means the Lord is going to judge. The Lord is going to judge who? The nations, all the nations get judged in the Valley of Jehoshaphat. And will plead with them there for my people and for my heritage Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations. So who are these nations? It's those people who have taken advantage over the land of Israel and over any Israelis, any Jews. And they have cast lots for my people, and they have given a boy for a harlot and sold a girl for wine that they may drink. Yea, and what have ye to do with me, O Tyre and Sidon? Here's two more cities. that are getting the judgment from God. And the coast of Palestine, that's the whole place, you know, along the coast, that would be Lebanon, or no, that would be, yeah. Who just got all the fires and the blown up thing?
Lebanon.
Who will render me a recompense? And if ye recompense me swiftly and speedily, I will return your recompense upon your own head. Because ye have taken my silver and my gold and carried into your temple of my goodly pleasant things. Well, at this time, we don't know that the temple was built yet. I think it was. I think Joel probably prophesied, before the Assyrian captivity. So there was a temple. Well, different people took stuff from the temple during Rehoboam's reign, you know, after the time of Solomon. Egypt took a bunch of stuff out of the temple. And then all these other people, you know, as soon as some other nation came over, then the king was kind of weak and says, okay, I'll pay you off. You know, and they stole stuff out of their own treasury and out of temple treasury and payable. Anyway, even Israel took stuff out of the temple from Judah. Anyway, well, they got an answer to God for that. Verse 6, and the children also of Judah and the children of Jerusalem, ye have sold to the Grecians that they might remove them far from their border. Well, obviously, the Assyrians did that. Behold, I will raise them out of the place whither they have sold them, and I will return your recompense upon your head. So, and I will sell your sons and your daughters into the hands of the children of Judah. So now these people, these other people, are going to be sold to the Jews. And what are the Jews going to do? They're going to sell them to the Sabaeans, a people far off. The Lord has spoken it. Well, who are the Sabaeans? First place we find the Sabaeans is going to be in the book of Job. These bad people who steal all Job's stuff. I mean, take his camels and all his stuff and wreck things. So who are these people? Where do they come from? Well, Sabaeans, ever hear the Queen of Sheba? It's the same word in the Hebrew. Well, she wasn't a bad person. But she had to go visit Solomon because she heard amazing things about him. She brought all different kinds of spices and gold and all kinds of stuff. And she went to Solomon, and she got all kinds of questions answered, and she was just blown away by how well managed that kingdom was that Solomon had, and it far exceeded any expectation she could possibly have. And at that point and on, and actually historically, they found it archaeologically, there has been an influence for 1,000 years in the area of Sheba. Now, where is Sheba? Well, Sheba doesn't exist because they finally self-destructed with a civil war and other people took them over. But Sheba would be Sudan, it's Ethiopia, it's what's on the other side?
Yemen.
So they probably had both sides, you know, they probably ran, and they actually, according to how historically things were, they probably had influence at different times historically all the way through Egypt. And so as they look at different Egyptian sarcophagi and stuff, a lot of these ancient Egyptians had far darker skin than the Egyptians that took over later. Yeah. So black people started in Egypt, you know, and went further south until other Egyptian things came up. That's all Ham, you know, that's all from the son of Noah. So anyway, all I have to say, these are the people. But what's interesting about the Sabaeans is the Sabaeans are not from Ham. The Sabaeans are Semitic. So it could be a group that came that would be descended from Abraham through his second wife, that came down into that area. So all that to say, it's from Shem and not from Ham. So it's a quite an interesting study talking about the Sabaeans, but they had rich resources, you know, as far as all the different spices and all the spice trade. And they said during Solomon's reign, they never had more spices in Israel than at any other time in their history, because of this connection between Israel and Sheba. So, and I think they got coffee then too, personally. Yeah, because Yemen coffee is really good. You know, Jürgen Jeffy stuff. Yeah, really nice, really yummy here. Okay. So the Jews are going to sell these people who sold their kids to the Sabaeans. Well, it doesn't necessarily mean their kids, but it can mean, you know, politically, how things go politically, but they're going to be sold to them. So people who took advantage of Israel and are going to be taken advantage of, you know, justice comes around, goes around, whatever, goes around, comes around, something. Okay, verse 9. Proclaim ye this day among the Gentiles, prepare war, wake up the mighty men, take all the men of war, draw near, let them come up, beat your plowshares into swords and your pruning hooks into spears. Let the weak say, I am strong. Assemble yourselves, come, and all ye heathen, and gather yourselves together round about thither, cause thy mighty ones to come down. O Lord, let the heathen be wakened and come up to the valley of Jehoshaphat, for there will I sit to judge the heathen round about. Put ye in the sickle, for the harvest is ripe. Come, get you down, for the press is full and the fats overflow, for their wickedness is great. Multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision, for the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision. The sun and the moon shall be darkened, the stars shall withdraw their shining. The Lord shall roar out of Zion and utter his voice from Jerusalem. The heavens and the earth shall shake, but the Lord will be the hope of his people and the strength of the children of Israel. What is this talking about? It's talking about gathering the nations into that valley of Jehoshaphat for a war. Beat your plowshares into swords and your pruning hooks into spears. Like even the weak person say, I'm strong, I'm getting part of this. I want to be a part of this battle. The battle is against who? The Jews. God is gathering the nations together to destroy the Jews. In the valley of Jehoshaphat, the valley that's called the Lord judges. He's putting his people, Israel, out there as bait. And he's calling the nations together. And, okay. Isaiah 34, verse 2 and 3 and 4. For the indignation of the Lord is against all nations, and his fury against their armies. And he has utterly destroyed them. He has given them over to the slaughter. Also their slain shall be thrown out. The stench shall rise up from their corpses. Didn't we just read about the stench of those grasshoppers in the lakes? One in the lake on one side, you know, the sea on the other side? And the mountains shall be melted with their blood. The mountains are going to be covered with blood. It's going to look like the mountains are bleeding, that they're melting with blood. All the hosts of heaven shall be dissolved, and the heavens shall be rolled up like a scroll. All their hosts shall fall down as the leaf from the vine, as the fruit falling from the fig tree. For my sword shall be bathed in heaven. Indeed, it shall come down on Edom and my people of my curse for judgment. The sword of the Lord is filled with blood, is made overflowing with fatness, the blood of lambs and goats, the fat of the kidneys of rams, for the Lord has a sacrifice in Bozra and a great slaughter in the land of Edom. Wild oxen shall come down on them, young bulls and the mighty bulls, and their land shall be soaked with blood and their dust saturated with fatness. For it is a day of the Lord's vengeance, a year of recompense for the cause of Zion. What Joel is saying gets said 100 years later in Isaiah. And then Isaiah 63, verse 1, who is this who comes from Edom with dyed garments from Bozra? Here's that word Bozra again. There's a sacrifice in Bozra. Who is it? The nations are going to be sacrificed by God. Who is this who comes from Edom with dyed garments from Bozra? This one who is glorious in his apparel, traveling in the greatness of his strength. I who speak in righteousness, mighty to save. Why is your apparel red and your garments like one who treads the winepress? I have trodden the winepress alone, and from the peoples no one was with me, for I have trodden them in my anger and trampled them in my fury. Their blood is sprinkled on my garments. I have stained all my robes. For the day of vengeance is in my heart, and the year of my redeemed has come. I looked, but there was no one to help, and I wondered that there was no one to uphold. Therefore, my own arm brought salvation for me, and my own fury it sustained me. I have trodden down the peoples in my anger, made them drunk in my fury, and brought down their strength to the earth. I will mention the loving kindness of the Lord and all the praises of the Lord according to all that the Lord has bestowed on us, the greatness and goodness toward the house of Israel, which he hath bestowed on them according to his mercies, according to the multitude of his loving kindness. Jesus is man. Why? Because Jesus is Jewish. His mother Mary is Jewish. I understand the Catholic Church has turned Mary into an Italian, you know. I mean, really. Didn't you ever watch the Passion of the Christ movie? I mean, give me a break. She's Jewish. Jesus is Jewish. He's Messiah. How about Revelation? So we got some prophecies in Isaiah saying the same thing that Joel is talking about. Revelation 6:12. I looked when he broke the sixth seal, and there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth made of hair, and the whole moon became like blood, and the stars of the sky fell to the earth as a fig tree casts its unripe figs and shaken by a great wind. The sky was split apart like a scroll when it was rolled up, and even the mountains and the islands were moved out of their places. When the kings of the earth and the great men and the commanders and the rich and the strong and every slave and free man hid themselves in the caves among the rocks of the mountains. And they said to the mountains and to the rocks, fall on us and hide us from the presence of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of their wrath has come, and who is able to stand? This is the day of the Lord, day of God's wrath. Yeah. The day of the Lord is mentioned five times in Joel. Joel 1:15, alas for the day of the Lord is near, and it will come as destruction from the Almighty. Joel 2:1, blow a trumpet in Zion, sound an alarm on my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming. Surely it is near. Joel 2:11, the Lord utters his voice from his army. Surely his camp is very great, for strong is he who carries out his word. The day of the Lord is indeed great and very awesome. Who can endure it? Joel 2:31, the sun will be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and awesome day of the Lord comes. Now, Jesus is coming back. He's not coming back as meek and mild, baby Jesus, sweet Jesus in the manger. No. He's coming back. Psalm 2, he's going to crush all of his enemies as though he has an iron scepter breaking fine china. Joel 3:14, multitudes in the valley of decision, for the day of the Lord is near, the day of decision. We're talking about sudden and terrifying judgment. And it's going to be sudden and terrifying for all those who aren't ready. But they're going to realize, and they're telling the mountains, cover us from the wrath of the Lamb. Can you imagine that? You know, when Jesus receives the scroll, John, as he is receiving this revelation, he looks up. And standing in the center of the throne is the Lamb that was slain. Jesus was slain for us. He was punished and he was killed for the sins of the world. For my sins, for your sins. And whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. But those people who don't call on the name of the Lord, the wrath of God remains on them, as it says in John chapter 3. And they're going to cry out to the mountains, hillsides, cover us from the wrath of the Lamb. Matthew 25, starting verse 31. Jesus says, "But when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on his glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate them one from another." All the nations are separated one from another. "As a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats, and he will put the sheep on his right and the goats on the left. Then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to drink. I was hungry and gave me something to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you invited me in, naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me.' Then the righteous will answer him, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? And when did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or naked and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and come to you?' The king will answer and say to them, 'Truly, truly, I say to you, to the extent that you did it to one of these my brothers.'" Who are Jesus' brothers? The Jews. This is the valley of decision. Who's doing the deciding? Jesus is doing the deciding. He's doing the deciding. And they are going to be judged like sheep and goat nations. And the sheep nations, the ones who did what? Take care of the brothers of Jesus. Who are the brothers of Jesus? The Jews, Israelis. God gave Abraham a blessing. Whoever blesses you, I'm going to bless. And whoever curses you, I'm going to curse. That still goes on to this day. And it will continue to go on through the tribulation period. The extent that you did it to one of these brothers of mine, even the least of them, you did it to me. Then he will also say to those on the left, "Depart from me, accursed ones, into everlasting fire, eternal fire, which has been prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not invite me in. Naked, and you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me." Then they themselves will answer, "Lord, when did we see you naked, hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked, sick or in prison, and did not take care of you?" Then he will answer them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, to the extent that you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me." These will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. So when we were talking about the harvest, we read it out of, you know, pull in the sickle and so on. This is quoted in Revelation chapter 14, starting verse 18. "Then another angel, the one who had the power over fire, came out from the altar, and he called with a loud voice to him who had the sharp sickle, saying, 'Put in your sharp sickle and gather the clusters of the vine of the earth, because the grapes are ripe.' Then the angel swung his sickle to the earth and gathered the clusters from the vine of the earth, and he threw them into the great winepress of the wrath of God. And the winepress was trodden outside the city, and blood came up from the winepress up to the horse's bridle for a distance of 200 miles. That is the blood that splattered on God the Son's vesture. The one who is coming from Edom. Edom is the place where the third of the Jews who are the remnant who survive will be squirreled away and hidden away by God. And they are the bait for the trapped, and all nations come together in a valley called Revelation 16, verse 12. The sixth angel poured out his bowl on the great river, the Euphrates, and its river was dried up so that the way would be prepared for the kings from the east. And I saw coming out of the mouth of the dragon, and out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet, three unclean spirits like frogs. For for they are spirits of demons performing signs which go out to the kings of the whole world to gather them together for the war of the great day of God the Almighty. Behold, I am coming like a thief. Blessed is the one who stays awake and keeps his clothes so that he will not walk about naked and men will see his shame. And they gathered them together to a place which in Hebrew is called Harmageddon. The Valley of Jehoshaphat is the Valley of Armageddon. That is the Valley of the Judgment of Yahweh Jehovah God. So as Peter preaches directly from Joel 2:28-32, he gives the whole prophecy. But it's like coming down I-17. The first part of the prophecy is the first mountain you see. But as you get closer, there's big separations between all the mountains in the valley. They're not one mountain. A bunch of different mountains. So this next prophecy that he was talking about has not happened yet. It's not fulfilled with the destruction of Jerusalem by, you know, Titus Vespasian or by you know, the Ark of, what's his name, or, you know, Bar Kokhba Rebellion, whatever where they took the menorah and the other things from the temple. Anyway, it wasn't, none of those things fulfilled the other two verses that Peter preached. But why did Peter preach? Here comes the pouring out of the Holy Spirit, and that happens before what? Before God pours his wrath out. Because the church was born in Acts chapter 2. The Holy Spirit coming in his people, the church is born, which is not Israel, even though there's Israelis in it. But what happens when at the end of the church age? The end of the church age starts the tribulation, the age of God's wrath, where he now focuses all of his attention on the nation of Israel. He destroys those nations that are coming against her, and he purifies her, as John the Baptist said, the refining fire. He's got the winnowing fork in his hand, and the fire is going to refine her. Okay. So it all starts off with grasshoppers. But it's all a picture of the judgment to come. So if you want to see how the grasshopper picture gets fulfilled in the book of Revelation, we need to go to Revelation chapter 9. We'll tell you who Joel's army is. It's in Revelation chapter 9. You really want to be part of the Rick joined it, call it the Manifest Sons of Destiny. You want to find out who they are? Okay, Revelation chapter 9. Then the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star from heaven which had fallen to the earth, and the key of the bottomless pit, or the shaft of the abyss, was given to him. And he opened the bottomless pit, and smoke came out of the pit, like the smoke of a great furnace, and the sun and the air were darkened by the smoke of the pit. Then out of the smoke came locusts upon the earth. There they are. They came out of the pit. And power was given to them, as the scorpions of the earth had power. They were told not to hurt the grass of the earth, nor any green thing, nor any tree, but only the men who do not have the seal of God on their foreheads. Who has the seal of God on their foreheads? The 144,000 virgin men Jews from the 12 different tribes. That's who had the seal. And they were not permitted to kill anyone, but to torment for 5 months. And their torment was like the torment of a scorpion when it stings a man. And in those days, men will seek death and will not find it. And they will long to die, and death flees from them. The appearance of the locusts was like horses prepared for battle. And on their heads appeared to be crowns like gold, and their faces were like the faces of men. And they had hair like the hair of women, and their teeth were like the teeth of lions. And they had breastplates like the breastplates of iron. And the sound of their wings was like the sound of chariots of many horses resting in battle. And they have scales tails like scorpions and stings, and in their tails is a power to hurt men for 5 months. And they have a king over them, the angel of the abyss. And his Hebrew name is Abaddon. And in the Greek, he is called Apollyon. Who is the king of Joel's army? Satan. Don't want to be part of Joel's army, guys. Manifest Sons of Destiny, no. Those guys are actually demons. Just want to tell you that. Read it right out of the book. Verse 12, the first woe is past. Behold, two more woes are still coming after these things. So I had to read that because that's how Joel's army is fulfilled. Joel's armies are demons. I just want to tell you that. Because people get this all messed up. Because they take it out of context and they're trying to, you know, incite people to get all excited to do something great for God. What are you doing? You're motivating by human pride. Why don't you just read the Bible in context? And if you do, your heart will be pierced just like the heart of the people who heard Peter preach and 3,000 people got saved. What must we do to be saved? Repent, be baptized in the name of Lord Jesus Christ. And you will receive the promise that you see. The promise is for you and your children and those who are far off. All those who will hear the message will receive the Holy Spirit. Verse 16 of Joel 3, and the Lord also shall roar out of Zion and utter his voice from Jerusalem, and the heavens and the earth shall shake. But the Lord will be the hope of his people and the strength of the children of Israel. So shall ye know that I am the Lord your God, dwelling in Zion, my holy mountain. Then shall Jerusalem be holy, and there shall be no strangers pass through her anymore. And you can go to Revelation 21, verse 27 to see that. You know, who goes there? Ain't no dogs in heaven. It says it right there. Anyway, verse 18, and it shall come to pass in that day that the mountains shall drop down new wine, and the hills shall flow with milk, and the rivers of Judah shall flow with waters, and a fountain shall come forth of the house of the Lord and shall water the valley. You could read Ezekiel 47, Revelations 22, verse 1. It talks about the river of God that's coming out from the temple. It's coming out, and there is, you know, it's got trees on the banks, and the fruit of this tree of life has 12 different kinds of fruit, one every month, and the leaves was for the healing of the nations. I mean, we're talking about the kingdom age. Verse 19, Egypt shall be a desolation, and Edom shall be desolate wilderness for the violence against the children of Judah, because they have shed innocent blood in their land. And we talked about in a couple of the minor prophets, we read about the destruction of Edom already. Verse 20, but Judah shall dwell forever, and Jerusalem from generation to generation, for I will cleanse their blood that I have not cleansed, for the Lord dwelleth in Zion. The Lord dwelleth in Zion. Mm-hmm. What's one of the names of Jesus? Remember what Angel Gabriel said? He shall be called Emmanuel, God with us. The Lord dwelleth in Zion. This is a great prophecy for the Jews, because it says God's still thinking about you. It's not all over. God's going to show up strong in your behalf, and it's going to come with great cost to all those people who are your enemies. Very encouraging. But in the middle of the book, it talks about the most important thing: to rend your hearts, turn back to the Lord with all your heart, with fasting and weeping and mourning. Rend your heart, not your garments. Turn unto the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and of great kindness. He doesn't want to have to do the chastising, but he does what he needs to do to save his people. But it's also an encouragement for us in the church, because God's got a plan, and he's going to work out his plan. There is going to be destruction of all nations. And God's going to separate those nations from the sheep and the goats. It's a judgment. That's going to be in the valley of Jehoshaphat, the place where God judges. Yahweh Jehovah God is judging the nations. And as he judges them, there's going to be a great slaughter with all those who are the enemies of Israel. God has a special place for Israel. God's made special promises to Israel. God hasn't made promises to the church, except that we are the bride of Jesus. And what are we waiting for? Jesus to come back and to take us home. Jesus says to his disciples, John 14, before he goes to the cross, he says, "Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, ye know the way." Thomas says, "I don't know where you're going, and we don't know how to get there." Jesus says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." Pretty exclusive. There's only one way to heaven, and that's through Jesus. No one gets to heaven but by Jesus. No one gets to the Father but by Jesus. In John 16, verse 33, "These things I have spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation." You will have affliction. You'll have trouble. "But be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." We in the church have a completely different set of promises. It's not about a piece of property on the planet, but it's about a relationship with Jesus Christ, the Lamb who is slain. Lord Jesus, we thank you for what you have accomplished for us. On the cross, you cried out after clearing your mouth with that vinegar, and you said, "It is finished." Thank you, Jesus, that you paid in full the debt of sin of the entire world. That whoever comes to you by faith, whoever believes what you did on the cross, you did for them personally, will not receive damnation, but will instead have eternal life. They won't be destroyed, but they'll be saved. Thank you, Jesus, for saving us, for dying in our place, for taking our full weight of the guilt of all of our sin and receiving God's wrath in our place. Thank you, Jesus, that we are not appointed to wrath. But there are those who are appointed to wrath, those people who haven't accepted you as their Lord and Savior, who haven't repented of their sins. And your wrath still abides on them. Lord, while there's still time, help us be your mouthpieces to proclaim the good news. You died on the cross for their sins. That whoever calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Yes, you Lord, that you help us be about your ministry of reconciliation. Help us declare who you are to all the people who you put into our life, dear God. Yes, you help us, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Holy Spirit, living breath of God, breathe new life into my willing soul. Bring the presence of the risen Lord to renew my heart and make me whole. Cause your word to come alive in me. Give me faith for what I cannot see. Give me passion for your purity. Holy Spirit, breathe new life in me. Holy Spirit, come abide within. May your joy be seen in all I do. Love enough to cover every sin in each thought and deed and attitude. Kindness to the greatest and the least. Gentleness that shows the path of peace. Turn my striving into works of grace. Breath of God, show Christ in all I do. Holy Spirit, from creation's birth, giving life to all that God has made. Show your power once again on earth. Cause your church to hunger for your ways. Let the fragrance of our prayers arise. Lead us on the road of sacrifice. That in unity the face of Christ will be clear for all the world to see. Let the fragrance of our prayers arise. Lead us on the road of sacrifice. That in unity the face of Christ will be clear for all the world to see.
Thank you, Lord Jesus, that on the night that you were betrayed, you took bread. And when you had given thanks, you broke it and you gave it to your disciples and you said, take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Lord Jesus, you took from the celebration of the Passover, from that Passover meal, the unleavened bread of that celebration. And you turned your disciples and our attention away from the original intent onto you. You gave us your body. You are the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. You are the Lamb of Isaiah 53, upon whom all the sins and transgressions were placed. And you received God's wrath, God's punishment in place of us. Thank you, Jesus. We eat this in remembrance of what you did for you, what you did for us. Thank you, Lord, that as it was originally intended, with a celebration of you redeeming your people from the slavery of Egypt, now we remember you and we remember what you did to redeem us from our slavery of sin, from our slavery of servitude to Satan. Thank you, Jesus, for giving us your body. Take and eat. And then in the same way, after that supper, that Passover celebration, you took the cup. And when you had given thanks, you gave it to your disciples. He said, take, drink, all of you. This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Thank you, Lord, for your blood and the new covenant. Not like all those other animals that were slain, or the blood of the lamb that was put on the doorposts and on the lentils, but your blood. It doesn't just cover sin. Takes away our sin. your blood that was poured out for the remission or the forgiveness of sins. Thank you, Jesus, that we aren't just forgiven, but we are cleansed. The blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all of our sin. Thank you, Jesus, for your blood. Thank you for purchasing us for God with your blood. Thank you for redeeming us from the slavery to sin. Thank you for saving us from our own sin. Thank you, Jesus, for your blood. Take a drink.
To the Lamb, to him who sits on the throne, and unto the Lamb, be blessing and glory and honor and power forever. Be blessing and glory and honor and power forever. To him who sits on the throne and unto the Lamb. To him who sits on the throne and unto the Lamb. Be blessing and glory and honor and power forever. Be blessing and glory and honor and power forever. Be blessing and glory and honor and power forever. Be blessing and glory and honor and power forever.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In Jesus' name. Amen.